He was ranked 84th in the Rolling Stones list of the 100 greatest guitarists of all time. Into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame as part of Aerosmith. And in 2013, Perry and his songwriting partner, Steven Tyler, were recipients of the ASCAP Founders Award and were also inducted into the Songwriters Hall of Fame. Joining him in conversation is music historian, radio personality, author, and talk show host Eddie Trunk. He is the current host of the syndicated radio show Eddie Trunk Rocks and the host of the VH1 show That Metal Show. We are here to celebrate the release of Rocks, My Life In and Out of Aerosmith. So without further ado, Joe Perry and Eddie Trunk.
I know that we're in a really nice bookstore and everything, but ladies and gentlemen, let me just say this one more time. Joe fucking Perry! Come on now, this is New York City! It is a supreme honor for me to be sitting here when Joe called me for the opportunity to do this. As a guy who grew up a huge fan of Joe's and Aerosmith, it's really special for me to be here. So thank you, Joe. And congratulations on Rocks coming out today. Yeah! And I'm sure all of you guys have it. And also, this is being recorded right now for my first ever podcast in front of a live audience. So thank you. Joe, reading the book. And as you guys will realize as you get into reading this amazing book, one of the most incredible things about it is there's so many of these autobiographies, but this book really had a way of taking the reader and putting it in the time and place when stuff happened. When you're in the set, when you're a kid, I feel like I'm walking through the woods with you as a kid. When you're in the 70s and the biggest band in the world, I feel like I'm on Giant Stadium, on that stage in Giant Stadium with you. When you're on drugs, I felt like I was on drugs. How did you accomplish that? Because the book is so vividly written and there's so many great quotes and you really capture the essence of the moment. How did you manage to do that?
Well, I spent a lot of time researching how people did autobiographies. When I was growing up, I always thought autobiographies were done by people finished with their career. They're off, you know, going to, retire. And I never felt that about Aerosmith. I mean, I always felt like there was another thing to do, another record to do, another show, another tour. And then this last couple of years, rolling into the 40th year and finishing the record with for Sony, and then personally, the kids have been moved out of the house. The youngest graduated from school. So a lot of things were like kind of a signpost, and it felt like it was time.
Well, there's so much in this book, and I took notes as I read it, and I want to go chronologically through this as quickly as we can. And then at the end of this, I know that you guys have submitted questions for Joe, and I see you guys all the way in the back as well, so hopefully you were able to get some of your questions in here, and we're going to kind of almost like a drawing, pull some paper out at the end and ask some of your questions as well and incorporate them in the conversation. But I think that where we should start is where it all started for you, Joe, and that is the music and the things you talk about, if you can, the bands that really shaped you as an artist, made you want to pick up the guitar and play. Who were those bands in a nutshell in the book?
Well, I have to start with obviously the guitar really caught my ear. There's something about the sound and also kind of what went hand in hand with that was hearing my uncle play Portuguese guitar, and I knew what you'd fool around with it, so I got a feel for that. And then at the same time, as I got a little older, I actually ended up getting a guitar. And at the same time, I was doing terrible in school. I had a learning deficiency, whatever you call it. I don't know, some kind of alphabet soup kind of thing that they call it now. Back then, they didn't call it that. They just thought it was like a discipline thing. Maybe you weren't working hard enough. So I ended up in study hall with a bunch of fuck-ups.
It was hard for you to get that first guitar, too. That's another great story in the book, because you always thought the guitar was coming, and your parents never delivered the guitar. You had so many false alarms until that one day when you finally got it, right?
Yeah, it was, back then, I mean, you have to remember, it was a different time. I mean, rock and roll was thought of as like kind of one step away from being a juvenile delinquent. I mean, it was like rock and roll went along with the ducktail hair and, a switchblade in one pocket and a greasy comb in the other. And it was, and my parents were trying to, steer me towards college. And I just knew that wasn't in the cards for me. And, rock and roll. I think probably the first real guitar kind of song were the Ventures, like Apache, songs like that where I really fell in love with that sound. And I knew it was going to be a long way till I could start making that kind of a sound, but I started with that $12 silver tone,
Well, thankfully, Mr. and Mrs. Perry finally buckled down and gave you that guitar.
Well,
we may not be sitting here today if that didn't happen, right?
Yeah, well, again, I get into the detail. And again, to address your first question about speaking and hearing my voice in the book, a big part of that I owe to David Ritz, who I'm working with. And it took a long time. It was a couple of years. Probably a year longer than I thought it was going to take to write the book. And a lot of that had to do with all those details that him capturing my voice and just spending time with me and hearing the way I spoke and the way I thought and just hearing all the details of the stories and just the way he wrote. I mean, he's a really talented, I hate to say ghostwriter, but that's what he does. He takes your stories and your thoughts and your ideas, and he makes it sound like you're talking.
Yeah, and
turns it into literature.
Puts you in that place and time, and the quotes and the stories and the voices of the characters as you move throughout the book, you realize are very vivid the way they're written. I mentioned this to you on my radio show last night. A character in the book very early on was the first manager of Aerosmith, a gentleman by the name of Frank Connolly. And when you read his voice and the quotes and the stories from his perspective in the book, I mean, it's a guy I wish I could have met because he sounded like a great character, and the way he's captured is fantastic.
Well, when I read some of the dialogue that when we started to finally hone in on it, I got goosebumps because I felt like he was literally there with a tape recorder. And of course, Frank died pretty early on in our career. He passed on and handed us off to Lieber Krebs down here in New York. And so it was impossible for him to ever met him. But I swear, he got him down so well, I couldn't believe it. I have to read it over and over again, because he really brings Frank to life.
What's interesting, too, is the earliest days of Aerosmith, and what I didn't know in reading the book is that Tom Hamilton was the guy you actually first connected with and met, right?
Right.
And talk right. about that, if you can, how you first met Tom, because that was really the seed of Aerosmith being formed, and then of course seeing Stephen playing with another band.
Yeah, well, Tom was, he grew up in New Hampshire. manager in New London, which was the town I went from Sotheby, where I met Stephen, and where we all hung out. And I was working in the greasy hamburger joint, and you know, I had my eye on what was going on. Everybody used to hang out there, and I talked to another kid that was a drummer, and he said, "I know this guy that teaches tennis over at the yacht club, and he was a guitar player, and we hooked up, and we loved the same music, and he had a Fender Twin."
That's all it took.
That helps, you know.
One of the most... Now listen, everybody knows this is one of the coolest guys that's ever walked the planet, right? But we all know that now, but when you read the book, you'll realize that even before he was Joe Perry from Aerosmith, he was damn cool because... And I love this, Joe. You quit school because you refused to cut your hair.
Well, there was a time...
You've got to elaborate on that.
Well, I'll tell you, I mean, again, you have to look back at the era. It was a time when people thought the Beatles had long hair. And, you know, I mean, that says it all. I mean, we look at their hair now and kind of chuckle when people say they had long hair, but it was a big deal back then. And there was the whole social layout at that time was one of like social upheaval and rebellion, and there was I mean, the biggest thing of course was for guys 16, 17, 18 years old was the Vietnam War, and you know, having friends going over there and not coming back or coming back missing arms and legs, and it was a big factor in the revolution that was going on in this country and around the world, and you know, in Europe. It was so, you know, the hair thing represented a lot of different things, and a lot of things were building up at that point in my life, and one of them was I knew I wasn't going to make it through high school, and I certainly wasn't going to make it through college, and achieve what I wanted to do, which was be a marine biologist. I wanted to go into science. I was excited about adventure and that kind of thing, and I just knew what was going to happen. And at the same time, as those doors were closing, rock and roll doors were opening, and it was like the music kept turning me on, and the Beatles came out, and I saw these four loners, or these four guys living outside of society, you know, creating an insane ruckus, you know, and it just looked like something I wanted to do.
What's funny, and you'll read this in the book, is that, you know, when you call home to tell you, you know, is there a problem with Joe at school? Is there any problem? No, what's the problem? But he won't cut his hair, that's why he's coming home. And your parents were pretty understanding, huh?
Well, you know, they kind of had to accept it because I was leaving one way or the other. I was going to hitchhike or they were going to come and pick me up, you know. And it was going to be a long ride. I mean, it was up in Vermont.
Steven Tyler, of course, and your relationship with him weighs greatly, of course, in this entire book and this entire history. And while a lot of people have made a lot of the sniping that you guys, the perceived sniping between you guys, I think it's important to note for people who only see those headlines from the early reviews of this book that, to me, I didn't read it walking away from it feeling like it was that at all. I felt like it was just the ups and downs of a brotherhood, a lifelong brother, and the ups and downs. Everybody has their battles and their good and bad moments. Because what I found incredible about it, Joe, is that you would have had these moments where you're like, you're never going to talk to this guy again. And then two pages later in the book, you're on vacation with him and your family somewhere, you know, yeah, having a great time.
Well, that doesn't make for great headlines, you know what I mean? It's, you know, the arguments do. And, you know, the fact that, I mean, literally we would have arguments in the 70s where everybody would leave the dressing room and people would stand outside and go, this band isn't going to last another game. And because they'd hear what was going on in there, and you guys know what I'm talking about. I mean, it was It was, I mean, we busted up a lot of furniture in those days. But we knew never to get into a fist fight, because we knew if we crossed that line, I don't think we could have come back from that. I mean, we always had that respect. We never got that far, but it got pretty heated, and that was the real challenge, to figure out how to deal with our personal differences, because there were also things about each other that we liked a lot that didn't have anything to do with music. I mean, again, to this day we'll still go scuba diving together, hang gliding or just. Whatever, go and shoot. I mean, I have to say, we both love guns. We collect guns, and we're always, if we get some time up in the woods, we go out and shoot.
Does Stephen ever scare you?
Because
guns talking mile a minute, and
shooting. No, not even when we're shooting full auto. Not ever worried. And that part of it is kind of left out. At this point, he's moved to LA, so we don't, and we've been both doing different things, so we haven't been doing too much of that lately. But it's an ebb and a flow. It's like you said, it's a brotherhood that it has its ups and downs. And as far as the stuff away from the music, and as far as the music goes, we deal with that. He's very much into pop and getting things meticulously right. And I'm into like letting stuff just rip, and I think that's been the real dynamic of what has made us songwriters, we wrote the majority of the stuff, but I gotta say the other guys have contributed a lot as far as the writing and playing, and Brad's guitar playing, Joey's drumming, the whole thing, and supporting us,
Well, yeah, that's another really important thing throughout the book that you reference a number of times. And, of course, so much of the spotlight when it comes to Aerosmith is on Stephen and Joe. But you mentioned the importance of Brad and Joey and Tom, and how those guys, the way this all works really is that those guys are confident in their own abilities and what they bring to the band, that they've been kind of cool with letting you and Stephen pretty much dominate the headlines, so if you will, but their importance is really evident to you throughout the book and how you write about them.
It's the five of us, and it's always been like a democracy in a majority of things, they're there to play their roles and kind of hold down the fort,
Does it amaze you? In this day and age, when we see so many bands, not nearly as old as Aerosmith, so many bands out there that are out touring, they have one, maybe two original guys, that of all the bands, of all the craziness, of all the books that have been written, that Aerosmith is one of the few standing in 2014, still the best.
With the hard work that we did, especially when we got sober, but the other part of it is we've been blessed, and just recently, with Joey, with his he thought he had an indigestion thing, and the next thing you know, he's this far from a heart attack, and he went in, and 10 days later he was back on stage. I mean, that something was awesome. We can only do so much, and we're all at ages now, and we see people passing away. Ralph Borman,
a very
important part of the first project, passed away a couple of months ago, and it's that time,
On a lighter note, there's a story in the book there's a few things in this book, being a huge fan, that I enjoyed reading about that I had no idea about. And one of them was, had no idea that, and maybe you guys didn't either, and you will after you read Rocks, that Aerosmith actually went to Harvard. Explain that for a second, Joe.
A couple of times, actually. Back when we were, you know, struggling and trying to really play, you know, anybody that's been in a band and you get together, you'll play any way you can. You know, you play for free, you pay to play sometimes now. Tom's sister, we played at her school when she was in school, and somehow we got connected with one of her friend's father, who was a professor at Harvard, and he wanted to do a study on motivation and how, you know, what motivated people to achieve, and he wanted to see if we would participate in the study he was doing. So for 2 weeks we went over to Harvard and went through all these psychological tests. We didn't know what it was going to lead to. I would love to get my hands on those files of all this stuff about what drives you, what do you want, why are you doing what you're doing? I mean, and frankly, I don't think anything came of it as far as getting any gigs or a record label. But you know, it was interesting. It was something to do, and they paid us $10 a piece a day, and you know, so we ate well and drank well for, you know, a couple of weeks. But so we did do that, and again, I'd love to get my hands on those tapes. I know they're somewhere. But then there was another time that the National Lampoon, the Harvard Lampoon, which is like a fraternity, inducted me as an honorary member. And I can remember they had me riding a fire truck down Mass Ave, all the way down to the it looks like the Flatiron Building where the National Lampoon was formed years ago. And they even have a bed there where the famous writer, the comedian, was there 100 years ago or something. But I went through the whole thing with all the indoctrination and going in and having being blindfolded and having to learn certain like fraternal kind of all kinds of weirdness. That you usually have to, you know, be part of a scene at Harvard, you know, to go through. And then it ends with a big banquet, and you smash all the dishes, and it's you know, very, it was as close as I was kind of going to get to college, you know. But it was fun. It was another thing, you know, Harvard's right there.
The other interesting thing, and again, in this short time that we have here, I'm just going to be scratching the surface of things to talk about that are in this book with Joe. But when people think of you and guitar player and Aerosmith and this legendary band, they would read a book like this and think that they're going to get sex, drugs, and rock and roll. You get some drugs, you get some rock and roll, but throughout the book, you don't get the crazy sex stories because, as you write about in this book, you've always been a very committed, monogamous, one-woman guy. And it was even caused a bit of a very unique. And it even caused a bit of a... Yeah. Everybody get a round of applause for that, Joe?
Hey, listen, I was... I did do my share of fishing. But it was always looking for the right girl. You know what I mean? I was never into like the one night stand for the sake of a one night stand. You know, I mean, I got a little crazy during the project years, but mostly I was looking for the right girl, and I found her.
Well, we should mention that. That ties into why I'm bringing this up, because if you heard my radio show last night, we discussed this a little bit. We may not be sitting here, and Aerosmith may not be still together, because Joe met his soulmate, Billy Perry, during the Joe Perry Project years, while you were out of Aerosmith. And her story and her impact on your life throughout this book is a big part of, obviously, of your life, but obviously this book as well, and how it really shaped the arc and ultimately kind of moved you back into going back with the guys in Aerosmith.
I think that that's true. I think that on a very basic level, it gave me, I was at the point where I had done the project and I played with a lot of talented guys from Boston, and I was looking around for another type of project, you know, either joining more of a super group kind of thing, in fact, I was working with Alice Cooper a little bit, and that's when I met Billy, and she really didn't know anything about Aerosmith, and it was only after she kind of discovered some old magazines and realized that we had indeed sold out Madison Square Garden and played some of these huge places and sold millions of records. So you know, I'm really thankful that she didn't know anything about me before that, because, you know, I mean, I knew for sure that she was she liked me for what I was, you know, when I met her, and not some, you know, rich rock star, because I was neither rich. And I was, you know, having trouble proving I was a rock star.
Joe, if you can't, I mean, for those that don't know the story, during those years that Joe was not in Aerosmith, the Joe Perry Project was not exactly an arena act as much as I and many loved the band. But you said last night there was a very memorable moment when you took your then-girlfriend, future wife, out on the first date at the restaurant to pay the bill.
Yeah, and they came back with the credit card cut in half. She had to pay for the dinner. Obviously our affection towards each other was already manifesting itself.
But I'm sure when that credit card came back, she started thinking, you better get your ass back in Aerosmith.
Motivated me to clean up my act. I mean, I didn't get totally sober, but I definitely was assessing what I was doing to myself, you know, with the drugs and the chemicals. And also, it gave me something that I was craving. I wanted a family, and I wanted kids, and I wanted to have that life. Making that work and getting that balance was a big part of what went on in the second half of Aerosmith's career and my career with Aerosmith.
Yeah, and of course the second half is well documented in the book too, because coming back together from Done With Mirrors to Permanent Vacation to this, the whole thing with Run DMC, I mean, the rise and fall, if you will, and rise again is just pretty remarkable. Most bands don't get that bite of the apple once, and for you to have had it twice with Aerosmith is pretty amazing to see. I mean, I'm sure you know from playing, you have a whole generation of fans out there that don't even know the 70s stuff. They found out about Aerosmith with maybe the remake of Walk This Way or something like that. So you've got all these generations you're dealing with.
That's definitely true. I mean, when we discovered that, we really weren't that cognizant of it when we were here. I mean, I'd read Billboard magazine and see what it was doing in the charts and that kind of thing. I mean, we were on the road, we toured, but when we went to Europe and all they wanted to talk about was the Run DMC collaboration, and we realized how much of an impact that it made, and also that the video, what that did, it literally broke down some walls, you know. I mean, getting Black acts played on MTV, and it did a lot of things we never expected from it. But yeah, that was a big part of it, but it was just one part of it, you know. Look, any band that would say okay to playing the Future Villains and Sgt. Pepper is going to take a chance playing for DMC, you know.
Good point. Writing this book for you, Joe, I mean, I've known you for a while. You're especially when you're not out promoting something on tour, you're a pretty private guy.
Yeah.
You're not in the tabloids, you're not out there, you very much lay low. Was it hard for you to do something that's this much exposing your life and your story and putting it out there in print?
Yeah, I think It was tough. I knew I was going to have to, if the book was going to be worth anything, I'd have to dig down. Because again, I didn't want it to be like a, just another sex, drugs, and rock and roll book. A lot of the stuff that we talked, we did, you know, came out and walked.